The best place to look for reliable information is in Kruger Library's databases. They are chock full of scholarly articles. But the free web, which is what we call the parts of the web that you can access through search engines like Google or DuckDuckGo, isn't exactly devoid of information. It's pretty much the Wild West in there, though, because anyone with access to a computer can publish whatever they like. So, you know, lots of weird, and also lots of good stuff. Now imagine finding a mushroom growing in the city dump. Could be poison, could be dinner. Probably should identify it before serving it to your mother. Same deal with information you find on the web. You'll want to check it for the 5 signs of accuracy before using it in a paper. They work, well enough, especially if you use them together. 1. Objective language. Does the author describe things as they are, as opposed to how you or I might feel about them? For example, on the first floor of Kruger Library, there is a Caribou and Einstein's, which sells coffee and bagels. That sentence was written using objective language. Note the absence of my opinion. Now let's try again with some not-so-objective language. Kruger Library's coffee shop has the best coffee and bagels on campus, and perhaps even in all of Winona. Both sentences include the same facts, but the second one reveals my prejudices. That's not inherently bad, but if I'm writing something that's supposed to be serious research, it calls my objectivity into question. It can make me seem unreasonable, and although unreasonable people aren't necessarily wrong, they also aren't noted for their even-handed treatment of complex issues either. It's a red flag. 2. Corroboration. Does the information agree with what you already know, or with other documents you've found? If not, it warrants a closer look. Information that stands out like that usually belongs to one of two extremes. 1, it's groundbreaking, like when the polio vaccine was discovered, or 2, it's garbage, like Holocaust denial. Real, groundbreaking research doesn't stay isolated because lots of people start using it in their own research. Garbage, however, tends to get ignored. That said, back in the 1960s during the Cold War, a Russian mathematician published about the diffraction of electromagnetic waves, which the Soviet government, and everyone else, ignored for a decade until American engineers found it and used it to build the first stealth aircraft. Awkward for the Soviets. 3. Origin. Where did this information come from? A well-respected organization like the Mayo Clinic, or somewhere else you've never heard of? Is the author an expert in the field, with the appropriate advanced degrees and matching job title? Because sometimes an expert in one field will write about something in another, like a physicist writing about education. That physicist might be excellent in his field, but being an expert in one thing doesn't make you an expert in anything else. Sure, he's really smart, but when an expert's writing outside of his field, he's writing as a regular Joe, and his ideas shouldn't carry the same weight as if he were writing about his area of expertise. 4. Evidence and references. If a study is legitimate, it'll provide a list of the documents its authors drew from and supply, usually in detail, the evidence upon which its conclusions are based. Evidence and references come in various formats, and that's fine. What matters is that they exist. Some documents, such as articles from popular sources like magazines and newspapers, won't include references. When that happens, you might want to refer back to number 2 and ask if the information's corroborated. Even then, they'll watch out. References and evidence are what keep people honest. 5. Mechanics. Little things like spelling and punctuation count. They show attention to detail. A writer whose work is full of mechanical or grammatical errors is a writer who doesn't pay attention to detail, or who's maybe working way too fast. Either way, not a confidence builder. Sure, we all make mistakes from time to time, that's normal. Serious and widespread mistakes, however, aren't. Also, writers are professionals, and a big part of their job is to communicate effectively. If they leave a lot of obvious errors in their work, they're not doing their job all that well, so you have to wonder what other mistakes they're making. No single one of these indicators can serve as perfect evidence that a source is accurate or not. But the more potential problems you find, the less you should be willing to risk your grade or reputation on a particular source. And yes, determining accuracy takes work. But don't forget, Kruger Library's reference desk and Ask a Librarian chat service exist to help you with precisely this kind of problem.